In this video, we're going to learn about owner's equity accounts, the basic owner's equity accounts and how they behave. We all know that every account in your chart of accounts has a debit side and a credit side. And depending on the type of account, sometimes the transactions are listed on the debit side for certain types of accounts and on the credit side for other types of accounts. The most important owner's equity account is the owner's capital. This is an account in your chart of accounts that reflects or shows the total money or value that the owner took from his or her personal funds or personal assets and put into the business. And of course, every chart of accounts should have a separate account for each separate asset so you can account for how much value of that asset is in the business. In this example, let's imagine that the company has $10,000 in cash and the company has $20,000 worth of equipment. Well, if that's the case, when the company starts, that means that the owner of the company has invested $30,000 worth of assets into the business, and the account that keeps track of how much the owner has invested in the business should say $30,000. Now, of course, the owner should also have a separate account called withdrawals. The reason for that account is to keep track of and take a total of all the money or all the assets that the owner took out of the business for personal, non-business use. For example, if the owner takes $2,000 of company cash out of the business for non-business use, that means that he or she would have to record that $2,000 in withdrawals, and the new amount of cash that the company has would be $8,000. The owner could also take home any other asset like equipment. For example, if the owner took home $5,000 worth of equipment, you would still have to record a withdrawal of asset from that owner of $5,000. That means the new value of equipment would go down to $15,000, and the new balance of the withdrawals account is $7,000. So as you can see, the owner invested $30,000 from his or her personal funds into the business, but withdrew $7,000 of cash and other assets from the business. And obviously, you would have to net out these two accounts to know that the actual amount of owner's equity that the owner has in this company is $23,000. So then you might ask, how do you distribute the net income from the income and expenses accounts to the owner's equity accounts? Well, we will use the same two owner's equity accounts we used a minute ago, except now we're showing other accounts in the chart of accounts. Let's imagine at the end of the quarter or the end of the fiscal year, the service income is $20,000. And let's imagine in this example company there are only two expenses, $6,000 and $4,000 here. Now this example is showing you how to distribute the income when the company is a sole proprietorship. That means there's only one owner. In order to find out what the net income is, as well as distribute it or give to the owner or put into the owner's equity account the net income, we use a special account in the chart of accounts called Income Summary. This is a temporary account that begins with zero and also ends with zero when we're finished. We make a series of debits and credits in order to move the income to the Income Summary account and make all our income accounts zero. We also move all of our expenses to the Income Summary account and make the balance of all of our expenses zero. In the days before the computer, this would help make sure that the income and expenses do not accumulate into the next accounting period, and they begin with zero at the beginning of this fiscal year or this accounting period. With the computer, it's not necessary to do it this way anymore, but at least we know in the Income Summary account that we can calculate the net income as $10,000. That's because we moved $20,000 to the credit side, and that was the income. We moved $10,000 worth of expenses to the debit side, and the net difference shows $10,000 more on the credit side than on the debit side. So we know the $10,000 is the net income. As I mentioned a moment ago, income summary also becomes zero. We take the ending balance of income summary and we bring it to the owner's capital account. This makes sure that the owner's capital reflects not only what they invested from their own personal pocket, but what they earned as their share of the net income. And of course, the last step in the closing process is to move the owner's withdrawals also to the owner's capital account. This way, withdrawals also starts with zero for the next accounting period, so you can clearly identify the withdrawals just for that time period. And when you find the end result of the owner's capital, we can see in this situation, the owner is left with $23,000 of owner's equity, all of which will be in the owner's capital account when you finish doing the closing entries. If you need to know how to make debits and credits, you can watch the supplementary videos about journal entries included in this course. But the end result is that we now know the ending period capital for this fiscal year, which is also the amount of capital that will begin as the beginning balance in the next fiscal year. Now let's see what it's like to distribute the net income in a partnership. Here we have a situation where the company has two owners, Holden and Gary. And as you would imagine, each individual partner has to have their own capital account, which keeps track of the amount that they physically invested into the business. And each partner should have their own withdrawals account that keeps track of how much money or asset that particular partner took out of the business. So these numbers for Holden are left over from the previous example. Holden invested a total of $30,000 of cash or other assets from his personal funds, and he withdrew $7,000 from the business for non-business reasons. Whereas Holden's partner Gary only invested $20,000 from his personal funds, and he withdrew a total of $3,000 from the business so far this fiscal year. Now let's imagine in this example, Holden and Gary share the profits 60% Holden and 40% Gary. So, just like in our previous example, income summary is the account where all the income and expenses get close to, so we can determine the net income and distribute the net income to the partners. But in this example, we see that the net income is the same as the net income in the previous example, except 60% of it belongs to Holden and the other 40% of it belongs to Gary. That means that Holden will have an increase of $6,000 in his capital and Gary will have an increase of $4,000 in his capital when we finally make income summary zero to distribute the net income. Now, of course, both owners have to net out their own withdrawals into their own capital account. So the $7,000 of Holden's withdrawals gets close to Holden's capital, and the $3,000 of Gary's withdrawals gets close to Gary's capital, and Holden's capital, or total owner's equity at the end of this fiscal year, is $29,000 up here, and Gary's owner's equity at the end of this fiscal period is $21,000. Now we need to clarify something about our new friend, income summary. We all know income summary is where we move all of the accumulated income for the fiscal year and all of the accumulated expenses of the fiscal year. This way, the income and expense accounts don't accumulate into the next period, and we can isolate exactly how much income and expense came in and out during a particular time period. And the income summary will give us our net income, but you should know that income summary is a temporary account. the account that we actually use as a permanent account to show the difference between income and expense in a prior accounting period is called retained earnings. So retained earnings will still show the difference between income and expense, but only in a prior period. And that's how QuickBooks works. So, for example, if you look at reports dated in the current period, you will see the income and expense, and you will not see them in retained earnings. However, if you look at a report dated after the fiscal year end, you will not see any income or expense accounts listed. Instead, you will see the net amount as net income, or at least the accumulated net income, in the retained earnings account. For example, if Holden's fiscal year ends on June 30, any report dated before June 30 will show this: the income in the income accounts, the expense in the expense accounts, and nothing in retained earnings. However, any report dated after June 30 will show that you have zero income and expenses, and the net amount of net income has been moved to retained earnings.